Now, this sheet is going to give you quite a bit of information, so hang on to it and refer back to it from time to time. It'll talk about your soil pH. Now, a plant will absorb nutrients typically through the roots, through the fine root hairs. That's why if you're transplanting seedlings, always be careful. Let's say you've got a line of seedlings. I'm going to erase this. Or some of it. You're out planting seedlings. You bought seedlings from the store. You got six packs of seedlings, and you've got an area that you're planting. You've made your rows. You've got stations along the way where you're going to put your plants. Now, there's a few rules when you're transplanting seedlings that you want to try to follow religiously. It'll increase your success. These are your planting stations. So sometime what we'll do, you take the six packs that you buy in the store. Plants are growing in them. They're really nice. And they're coming out, and you take and you put a plant here, one 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 plant here, and then come back and start putting water in your holes. Don't do what I just outlined here. The reason why is because when you take those little seedlings, that are in those squares, that come out of those squares, you notice that they're root bound, right? You notice all the little fine roots? Yes? Okay. When oxygen hits those, it dries out the fine. If you drew a root, it has fine little hairs in the root. And those are the ones that uptake water, nutrients, etc. When oxygen hits those, they're really, really fine, finer than our hair, very, very fine, almost like silk. It dries them up. And as they dry up, they're no longer able to pick up nutrients and water. So what you've done is, by staging the plants, because it makes sense, stage them all, put water in the holes, and then come back and one by one by one by one by one by one plant them. These are drying out, and you'll lose. Sometime you'll lose almost 30% of your plants. They'll die. You put them in water, and those little guys, because they're delicate, they won't be able to absorb the water because you've ruined all those roots along the outside that are able to pull water in. So always make sure that when you're transplanting, as a rule, always transplant in water. Fill those holes with water. Fill them all with water. Fill all those holes with water first. And then come along and put your seedlings into them. And then compress the soil back around the seedlings tightly, because you don't want any oxygen. Again, oxygen's not your friend with that young plant. You want to enclose all the soil back around the roots. Everything back around the roots, tight. Now, it's wet, so it's going to be muddy, you know? It's not going to be like tight like you pack soil. But you don't want to get rid of all the air gaps. That's the goal. You want to reduce all those air gaps around that plant. And your success will be almost 95, 96, 98% with your plants. You may lose maybe just one or two, or none at all. All right? Has everybody been doing that? Okay. Start doing that. Always transplant in water. Yes, Harrison. The container or... Okay. Okay. What they're telling you, what they're describing to you is that when a seedling or a plant will grow in a container, and if any of you ladies grow flowers or at home or plants at home, when it's restricted in a container, the roots are going to start moving in a circular fashion. They're going to become root bound. And you'll notice that spiral something, the roots are just running around and around and around. So what the person was telling him, was encouraging him, is to break up this situation here. Best thing is to dip that plant in water. Once you pull it out of the container, put it in water, and then gently try to loosen those roots and get a few that are going the opposite direction, or just if they're out of that spin, you're getting them out of that spin. So you're just trying to loosen them a bit. Now you're going to lose a little soil as you do that, and you don't really want to disturb another thing. You don't really want to disturb this root ball core here. You want to try to really be careful not to really disturb it, but if you can get a few of the roots going in a different direction, that's a positive. But absolutely do not disturb and deconstruct all this soil where you just have roots and just a plant, little plant with just roots. And now you're putting it in the soil. If you do that, what's going to happen is it won't die. It's not going to do very well, but it slows it way, way, way down. It slows that seedling way, way, way down. They're already slowed down when you plant them, but if you don't disturb this root ball, break a few of those off with Harrison and move them, get the roots going in a different direction if you can't. One or two or three is great, because it'll break up that pattern. But don't disturb the core, because then that seedling, as these start moving out and they're picking up more food, this will start greening up, and it'll take off. And it'll take off on you. It'll do that quickly. So that would be the goal here. If you're going to, as you do that, great question. But always again, fill your holes with water, and then come back and put your plants in. Put those six packs in. Water first, water first, water first, water first. Your success will be awesome with whatever you're planting, if those are planted in water first thing around. Another item. Question's always, now, when do I need to start adding fertilizer to my plants? Usually by the time you have you're planting tomatoes, you're planting whatever you're planting, in that plant, you'll have, your principal leaves and will come out. And when you start seeing, after you've transplanted it, and you start seeing the growth tip giving you new leaves, or they start becoming dark green. They start green, we call it greening up. When that plant starts greening up, is a time that you could begin to give it just a little bit of a push. Not heavy, just a little bit of a push, and you can start helping it to move forward. But wait till they green up. Don't bother it while it's not started to give you new leaves and fresh leaves. And that's helping you to realize that the roots down here have found new food, and they like it, and now they're on their way to start, to start doing what you want them to do. They're on their way to maturity. That would be the focus for adding more fertilizer to the plant. Now, where typically is fertilizer taken up through the plant? In the roots, absolutely. great place, but also your plants will receive nutrients through the leaf. One of the elements that your plant uses the most is nitrogen. Nitrogen is responsible for several applications in your plant. All the cells in the plant have nitrogen, but for the principal part, nitrogen is creating all this framework, that woody growth, the heavy growth of a plant. It has other things that it does in the plant, but we'll boil it down for this one in your note, take a look. But the nitrogen helps to promote this, your heavy growth. But you don't want to overdo your nitrogen. If you were testing your soil sample, you don't want, if you're sending a soil sample in to just check where your nitrogen levels are, you don't want them above 30 parts per million. You don't want to get it higher than that while the plant is growing. Nitrogen will do some other things to plants also. If you have too much, it will desiccate a plant. It'll dry it out. It'll kill it. Nitrogen will kill, or what they say, burn. It'll burn the plants. Now, how you can know if you put too much nitrogen in? The uptake cycle for nitrogen is typically within a range of 10 to 14 days. Some will say 10 to 12 days. But 10 to 14 days, if I've done something that's not nice to that plant, especially when it comes to nitrogen, you'll know it within that period of time. So also, if you're applying nitrogen, don't apply. If I put day one, don't come back at day seven and add more. The plant takes time to assimilate that nitrogen and to get it into its tissue. So give it that 14-day cycle before you consider that you're going to add more nitrogen to the plant. Now, because nitrogen is an element that's used a lot, you know, our air that we breathe, if in volume, let me erase some things, if in volume, the air that we breathe is about 78% nitrogen. But it's in a form that the plants can't use. Yes. You would have to send it into a laboratory to be able to get that result. But aside from doing that, if you have too much nitrogen, your plants are going to talk to you. They're going to tell you. If you've got too much, they're going to burn, or the leaf, the edges of the leaf will look like they're drying up. You'll have a real beautiful leaf on a plant, and the edges will be drying out. They'll look dry. They'll look dead. That'll start happening on your leaf stems, on your leaf surface. And that lets you know right away if you've made an application of nitrogen, I got way too much. And if you see that, start watering around those plants. Now the plants already received that nitrogen and it's hurt it, but so that if you use pelletized material, and if it's slow release or fast release, those pellets, if they're under the surface of the ground, they're going to keep releasing nitrogen. So you want to start releasing it. The nice thing about nitrogen, it is a negatively charged ion. And what that tells you, or what that says, is it will move with water. Anytime you apply water to a negatively charged ion, it's going to move with that water. It's mobile. And nitrogen is very mobile inside of a plant. That's why, and I'm coming to that one on our leaf, that If you're in trouble, water more, that'll pull you out of more damage with the pelletized nitrogen. It'll pull you out of that problem. But what happens with nitrogen use, and they're really watching this in several states. With plants, is that as you apply, I'm gonna go through two different things here. When you're applying pellets, pelletized nitrogen, that's called top dressing. And the guys, when you apply, they'll tell you always water it in. When you apply your nitrogen, you wanna water it in. If you fail to water nitrogen and just kinda let it set there, it will volatilize and go back into the atmosphere. You'll lose that nitrogen. The sun will volatilize that nitrogen. And when I was saying that we have 78% of N2 in the air, it's not available, but bacteria makes it available. Oxygen, I think, is another 30, 28, something like that, but you've got about 78% that's of oxygen and nitrogen in the air. Bacteria do the work of conversion, especially like with, for instance, with ammonium. Two bacteria that are responsible for conversion of nitrogen, and that would be the Nitrobacter. Nitrosomonas bacteria, converting nitrogen to first to nitrite and then to nitrate. Nitrate is how the plants receive nitrogen. Typically, for plants to use the fertilizer that you're giving, a chemical process has to occur. And with the nitrogen, this is that process. These two bacteria, Nitrobacter and Nitrosomonas, will convert the nitrogen to nitrite and into nitrate, and then your plants can uptake it and use it. So, after that's done, so again, just quickly to review, 12 to 14 days on intervals between nitrogen. If you give it too much, you know you're gonna burn the plant. But one option you do have, and I would say this is a better option than, you know, there's always more than one way to skin a cat, right? As that saying goes, more than one way to get to a solution. If you apply nitrogen foliarly to your plants, spraying it on the leaf surface, you don't have the issue with pelletized product is going to release, nitrogen moves with water, it will draft through the soil. And as it drafts past the soil, your plants pick up that nitrogen, your roots pick up the nitrogen. And oftentimes, many of our plants, they will send roots downward, and they send a lot of roots horizontally. So typically, wherever your canopy line is of your plant would be an indicator of how far your roots have gone out, and sometimes they go farther. That's just kind of a rule of thumb, not exact at all, by any means. So as that nitrogen is being dissolved in water, it's passing by your roots, and those fine hairs on the root we talked about, they're picking up that nitrogen and pulling it up into the plant. But what happens with that nitrogen, it just doesn't stop there, it keeps moving. Wherever water's going, nitrogen's going with it. And as a result, in California, I think along our Gulf Coast, a lot of the places where farming is being done, you have a lot of nitrate poisoning in the water. You've got a lot of nitrogen that's moving down into your aquifers. If you apply nitrogen to the leaf, you make a better use of that product, because whatever you apply foliarly or through a spray, you wash the leaf with it, and you're done. That nitrogen goes no place else, and you use exactly what you need. And you give it to the plant, and that's it. There's nothing that you lose in that process unless you overmix and you've got a lot of it sitting around. But you can always, if you've got more plants, spray it or hold it, keep it out of the sun, and then spray it later. So that's an option with a foliar application of nitrogen that works quite a bit better because its uptake, the uptake is just as fast. So there's another tool. I'm not saying that this is bad. This is another option. Okay? Everybody got that? All right. Just another tool to put in your tool bag. A lot of states are monitoring the nitrogen load in soil because farmers typically will over-fertilize, and there's repercussions environmentally as a result of it. So let's look at our nutrients, our principal nutrients. Remember I said there's 20 essential, 20, 17, 18, 19 essentials. And we'll talk about CEC capacity briefly. But your potassium, phosphorus, calcium, your sulfur, and your magnesium. Five principal cations that you need in your soil. Nitrogen, oftentimes with your organic matter, your soil will have a fair amount of nitrogen as well in it. But these guys, if you don't do a soil sample, and your levels are, and you don't have a high pH, if you don't have a high pH in your soil, and you'll know that through your soil samples when you take it. Does everybody have high pH soils here? As far as you know? Has anyone done their soil samples? You just got your soil sample. Where's your pH level at? Harrison, do you have your soil sample? Anybody that has it? Let's see where you're at with here. So you've got high pH. You've got high alkaline. Typically areas like this that are, now yours is 8.2. Yours is 8.2. So you've got an alkaline soil. You've got a high pH. So I think most of you in this area are gonna have that, you're gonna have that issue with your soils. You're gonna have a high pH, which is not insurmountable. It doesn't mean you can't farm or you gotta stop and do something else. It's just that it's good to know, and now you can address it through a couple different ways. Elemental sulfur will help you. Applying organic matter to the soil will help you. That'll help you bring that down over time. It'll take a little while unless you want to fast track it. But there's ways to fast track it, or there's ways just to kind of work with it and keep bringing it down, bringing it down, bringing it down. So that's an option. One thing that does happen in high pH soils is the phosphorus is locked up, and you typically have high levels of calcium is always kind of a marker for that. And it locks up a lot of other nutrients. So with a high pH soil, calcium is something you never need. Even when you balance it, because you'll have plenty of it there, you always have a lot of this element. And calcium is a structural element to the soil and to your plants. They need it. In fact, you can't grow without calcium, because it's responsible for cell division. It's responsible for the tightness of your plant, of the cell structure. It's really, really a critical element. In fact, it's on your sheet, on the sheet that you have in front of you for your nutrients. It'll be in your macro division. Calcium's at the top. It's of number C4. Yep, that's at the bottom of the page. Now, a couple things with calcium. It's needed for new cells to form, but calcium is something it's an element that's not mobile. So when you plant, your calcium needs to be in the soil. It's not something at the very bottom of that page of the. It's on this, do you see IC4? Yep, it's the top of IC4. Okay, great, at the bottom, yeah, yep, you're right. Okay. So take a look just briefly at that. Calcium is generally immobile in the soil, so it needs to be in the soil when you plant. But that's an element here that none of you will ever have to pay any money for to amend with gypsum or lime or any of that kind of stuff. You won't need it. You've got plenty available. But it's an essential part of cell structure. Even it determines the calcium that your plant uses. It's going to determine how well your fruits or squash or otherwise, how well they hold after they're taken off. After you harvest them, how long they keep and how well they keep. That'll be a marker for it. Potassium, a good way to think of potassium and the need for potassium, anything that's starchy is gonna need a lot of potassium. Your potatoes, going to, that's one that's for sure that's going to need a fair amount of potassium. It'll take a lot of potassium for that plant. As you look at it, potassium absorbed as ion K, and that's usually how you'll find potassium in the NPK on your fertilizer packets in a combine. The K is always for your potassium. It's responsible for the opening and closing of the stomata, and they happen to be at the bottom of the leaf. But potassium is responsible for helping those to open and close. Transpiration happens that way. Also for translocating sugars and forming starches. That's why in most of your starchy foods, potassium is needed. Even in your fruit, winter squash, summer squash, it's needed. You've got to have the potassium. Corn, because corn is starchy. Very, very good. Very good point. Yep, corn is starchy also. Magnesium is one of those, also it's one of those negatively charged ions. Now it's really easy to know when you're low in magnesium, especially with cucurbits, like your squash, your pumpkins, because it's mobile in a plant, and I'll go backwards to the nitrogen also and explain that mobility, or talk a little bit about that mobility. If you've ever noticed on your squash, since it's on a vine, it's a vining plant, you'll have your really nice leaves that have developed along the way, big, nice, healthy leaves. At the very end of that, you have where your leaves are just beginning again. Little small leaf, a little bit larger leaf coming here, and then your leaves are a little bit bigger, kind of like a progressive movement like that. Notice that on your plants? Okay. When you've got a magnesium deficiency, you'll find that you'll get a distortion here. These will start to curl and twist and curl and twist and curl and twist and just be stunted. It's like it stops growing. Typically, that's a sign that your magnesium is low. You've got a low level of magnesium in your plants when you start seeing that distortion at the growth point. And it also, but it's also a key indicator that that nutrient is mobile because it's moving through that stem and you're seeing the results at the growth point. So where it needs it now, it's not there. So if you've got that problem, add magnesium to your plant. And you can add typically one of the products that has a lot of magnesium that you can put your hands on quickly is Epsom salt. So take that Epsom salt, sprinkle it around, water it in, and I tell you within a matter of that uptake cycle, within about 14 days or so, you'll start seeing a change. Your plant will never undo this curling and distorting and twisting, but what will happen is that where your next joint is, that it'll grow past it, and it'll begin again. And you'll start having really nice leaves, and your progression will be just like it's supposed to be. It'll bypass that problem, and the plant will just keep moving along. Nitrogen also is just like the magnesium. It's mobile in the plant. And you'll see nitrogen, like for instance with your tomatoes, or other plants, the bigger leaves at the bottom will start getting yellow. And that's telling you your plant's running out of nitrogen. And what the plant does to help itself survive, it will move the nitrogen out of these bigger leaves, send them up to the smaller ones to survive, you know? Awesome thing that God has done. It's So it sends them upward, but that gives you a telltale sign that, hey, my plant's running out of nitrogen, so I need to apply nitrogen. So again, you've been given two tools. You can come back, use the ground app, water it in, or you can apply nitrogen to the leaf and get that answered right away. So you've got two tools to use now, all right? Both, you don't need to do both, but either one or the other. This we always consider as the most efficient because I'm not wasting nitrogen. It's not going to parts unknown. I think what the U.S. government did just to check and to see nitrogen in its movement, and they found by making it radioactive, the nitrogen moved for about 7 miles, either laterally or otherwise. Wherever water was running or moving, raining, they found it way, way, way past somewhere else. That's just how it moves. Yes. You won't mix it. Typically, it'll come like in a pellet form. Just apply it around the plant, and then water it in. Yeah, water it in. Two items for your to water in, to water into your plants. That would be your nitrogen. Is another one you can do that with. But for deficiencies with magnesium, the Epsom salt is going to be the one. Now there are liquid forms of magnesium that you can purchase, and you can spray it on. So you've got, again, every fertilizer that's available for a ground app is available in a foliar leaf application to be applied. Foliar won't change your soil, won't change your soil breakdown at all. It just gives the plant immediately what it needs, and it does it very efficiently because you don't get a waste factor. But it won't, if you're deficient, and a great question that he's asked, because if in my soil I do a soil sample, and it tells me that my magnesium is low, I can apply all the magnesium in the world here, and that plant will eat, and it'll feed it, and it'll do well. But it won't change what's happening in here. Won't change this at all. If I get a sample back and it tells me my magnesium is low, I need to add magnesium. If it tells me my calcium is low, I need to add calcium to my soil. If my phosphorus is low, I need to add phosphorus to my soil. Because there's certain elements. Magnesium is one that moves. There's others that are immobile. For instance, calcium. You all have lots of calcium. But let's say you're living where I live. I'm on sandy soils. I've got very, very low calcium in my soil. I need to add it. I got to put gypsum on. I can get a liquid calcium, and I've used it for our trees with the orchard when I was farming commercially in Washington. We make leaf applications of calcium because it's so important. We're putting calcium to the leaf, even though we have calcium in the soil, but I need it in the soil as well. So gypsum, lime, otherwise, those are tools to use when you need calcium in your soil. You guys are blessed, you don't need that. You don't have no need for calcium. So whatever's missing in the soil, you do well to replace it and put it into the soil. Spring the leaf is exactly, it's for the crop that you're farming right now. It gives it exactly what it needs, even with your nitrogen. When you're putting organic matter into your soil, there's a dentrification process that's going on, or a recycling process that's happening. That's why organic matter is so important. I was going to talk about one of those things. I'll put it back up. But as you apply organic matter to your soil, and you're putting in leaf mulch, alfalfa, all kind of things at the top of your soil, and you're coming back and you're incorporating them into your, into this area, into this level. You're rototilling those in or plowing them in or doing whatever. As they break down, as those leaves and the alfalfa, the stems, as they break down, they're reverting back. Everything that's in them is reverting back and coming back to the soil. The bacteria, your worms, all the organisms, the fauna that's in the soil, all those organisms that are in the soil are chewing and eating and breaking those things down, and those elements that are in them come right back again. In fact, when you take a leaf sample in, oftentimes they'll dry it, crush it, and then analyze what's in that leaf back to all the elements that are there. Bring it to powder, and then they'll examine all the elements that are there to let you know where you're at with your with that particular plant at that particular stage. So all that to say is, with your organic matter, you're putting nitrogen back in your soil, you're putting phosphorus back in your soil, you're putting the potassium back in your soil, magnesium goes back into the soil. All the things that it took to create that plant that you're putting back in, all those elements are going to end up back into your soil. They won't go anywhere. Yes. Yes. No, they typically won't. Most of your seedlings are not going to be loaded with a lot of nutrients. They're not going to invest a lot of money to do that. Especially because initially when a seed has quite a bit of energy in it, and as it opens and sprouts and sends root out and sends your, if it's a dicot or a monocot, you start getting your first leaf or second leaf or third leaf, it's only about that time that now this plant is wanting something to eat. Yeah, your first dicotyledons that come out, your dicotyledons on your beans and ones that have two principal leaves, it's only until they get to the first, to the second leaf, to now where energy's gone, and now they need something to consume. And usually that's about the time they're ready to hand them over to you. Sometime you'll have seedlings that are larger and they're bigger, you know, when I'm kicking. But they'll have enough, and they'll feed them. They'll give them a little food to keep them alive and to keep them moving until you get them home. But when they get to your soil is when they need the food to move forward. There's a term I said we would just talk briefly about, and that's the CEC capacity of soil. That's an interesting term. But what it means, what it stands for, is the cation exchange capacity. Just think of it, think of your soil as a bank. Whatever you deposit into this bank is what it's going to have. Now, the soil has the option of holding that material that you deposit. What helps it hold it, if I've got sandy soils, real sandy soils, what I put in it is going to keep moving. The sand is real, has great capacity. It aerates very nicely, and it drains really, really well. So it's hard to hold water in sand. But if I use and organic materials, if I use organic materials and I start adding leaves, and I start adding alfalfa mulch, I start adding things to it, it's filling gaps in the soil. My organic matter is making now, when water comes through, I got sponges, and it's collecting, and it's holding, and it's holding, and it's holding. Nutrients that are breaking down, rather than them passing straight through and just keep going, as I build my soil with organic matter, it's now, my bank is getting bigger, because the organic matter that I put into it, it's actually now holding it. The organic matter is holding the nutrients. There's something to hang on to, rather than just keep passing down through the sand. So, always as a farmer, every season, during the season, mulch, add organic matter, keep adding organic, incorporate that until you get your soil where it's very, very nice. Then you go to a no-till cycle. And you want to get to a no-till cycle just as quickly as you can. And the reason why is because as you keep adding organic matter, you're building up your bacteria, you've got earthworms in there working, you've got all these organisms now that are just happy. There's just so much to do in here. And every time you bring a plow through or a rototiller through and you cut and disturb, they're just like, oh, they're just traumatized. All those organisms in the soil are just like, wow, what's going on? Because they had all the old roots from your plants that were growing before that were there, and they're breaking those down, and they have all this activity that they're doing, and you're coming through every time, and you're just turning their world upside down. That's why they advise that as quickly as you can get to a no-till cycle to do it, because it's better all the way around. Less for erosion if you're on hillsides, or otherwise you don't have the type of erosion that you naturally get. But when you've got poor soils, you do have to spend that time incorporating and getting things into your growth zone. You've got to do it. So don't hesitate to do that, but as quickly, do it as quickly as you can get past that and start using and allow your organic matter to start breaking down. Then you can top load. Then you can start applying a lot to the surface and allowing whatever will work its way down, organisms will work some of that material down into the growth area for your plants. So you want to move to that place as fast as you can, but this capacity of all this organic matter in here builds your exchange capacity. So when you plant plants now and they are coming out and they're taking up the potassium, they're taking up the phosphorus, and the roots are pulling this material, they're not exhausting it because you've put so much in that continues to break down. They're taking what they need, and you've got new material that's breaking down, making it available for the next year. Usually whatever you put in the soil this year, you just get a tiny percent of it this year, but next year it becomes available. So you're on a cycle that way. That's why every year you want to be adding and adding and adding and adding. So that whatever I put in this year, I'm not going to get the most out of it, but now next year it's going to be available, and I'm adding that year also. So then the following year, I have even more available to my plants, and so on and so on and so on. And you're building it up that way. That's how you want to build.